I was just thinking about the story of the woman at the well and how Jesus said to her when she flicked the conversation over to worship and you say this and we say this and all that sort of stuff. And Jesus says, but the hour is coming and is now here when true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. And I was just struck by the fact that, you know, sometimes we make it about what we do or don't do, but he's seeking people. He's seeking you. He's seeking me. The ones who are the worshippers. He's always been seeking relationship with us. And he said, and it's now here. The hour is coming and is now here. So it's already happened. What he had intentioned with the Father in the Spirit from the beginning of time is now our experience. We've come into that place and we get to come freely and because of what Jesus has done. So Psalm 95 verse 6 says, O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. So let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, but who is also our Father. Isn't that amazing? Let's worship him.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let me be a sweet, sweet sound.
I exalt
are holy and you are wondrous and amazing and above and beyond anything that we can even dream or imagine. And yet you came near and you draw us to yourself and you made a way, Jesus, you made a way to take us back to the Father. And so we, your children, as we worship you, as we come together as your kids in the family, we worship you, we honor you, we say thank you. We say thank you for loving us. Thank you for loving us so much that you were not willing that any should perish, that you were willing to pay whatever price was necessary to restore us to yourself. And we, our hearts are so thankful, and we worship you. We honor you in our midst and in each other. And we come before you because of Jesus and in Jesus, because in him we live and move and have our being. Thank you. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome, everyone, and any visitors to the church as well. Now, birthdays this week, we have Heather Jones's birthday is on Saturday. So if you see Heather, wish her happy birthday. There's no wedding anniversaries I know of, so please be sure to use the Check-In Queensland app to register your attendance at church. This is an important part of helping us meet our contact tracing obligations. Please join us for morning tea after church today, following the COVID rules of being seated at the tables to be served. Thank you for your support in both matters. This coming week, we have our last contagious session at 2:30 today. On Tuesday, we have Connect Group at 9:30 a.m. On Wednesday, we have KYB at 9:30 a.m. and then the Ladies Bible Study at 7:15 p.m. On Thursday, we have the ASD Support Group at 7:30 p.m. And on Friday, we have the Connect Group at 9:30 a.m. And of course, next Sunday, our morning worship, and also it's Father's Day next Sunday. Upcoming events. On the 12th of September, we have our special guest members coming for our mission spot. Bring your own lunch at Brains after lunch. And on the 19th of September, we have the members' quarterly business meeting. We have hospitality rosters for September to November are now complete. So if you haven't received yours, please speak to Shannon or email the church or church office. And just a reminder to let you know that the care cards are still going, and you'll find them just in the back of the pews. And it's a good way to get your pastoral needs to the attention of Pastor Rhys and the pastoral care team. And that's all from me. So I'll see you next week.
Thanks, Judy. This Sunday is Chappie Sunday. And so we have a video from Scripture Union Chaplains. And to show you now, this is just a part of our supporting. We've got 7 Chappies across this region. And so it just gives us the opportunity to be a little bit more aware of their work. And Tony will come after that to lead us in a time of prayer. Thank you.
Said to me, I think your mum's got something to tell you in her room. So I went down to mum's room and she was on the bed just broken and sobbing. And I had no idea what was going on. And my uncle had said to me, Amanda, your father's been killed in a car accident. It was 6 weeks before I returned to school. And in that time, there was no one. We wonder what it could have been like. With a bit more support, we could have been a bit stronger, I guess, in that time, rather than falling apart.
Well, in 2011, I lost my dad to cancer. It was about a month it took for him to slowly pass. He was gonna be out by my birthday, like they were gonna treat it, but then he had a brain bleed. And then it was about a week until he died, and he ended up dying on my birthday. So my dad was my best friend, so then losing him was something that was sort of very hard to adjust to. Amanda was there the whole time throughout that. So Amanda came in and she would just sit there at the hospital and would chat and play board games.
When the opportunity to become a chaplain became available, it was a real opportunity to make sure that no child on my watch would ever have to go through what I went through alone. When his birthday was looming and Dad's stats were not looking really positive, we made a decision we were going to have a birthday party for Lockie the day before his birthday so that Daddy was still with him.
And she made a bunch of meals when my dad passed for my mum so she didn't have to cook for a farewell.
It was heartbreaking to see Lockie and his mum go through that, and to really hard to know how as a teacher you could support his family and also the other kids in the class.
One error that a chaplain in my situation could have is that my experience would be the same as Lockie's, and Lockie, I know what you're going through because I did the same. Whereas his was really different. He had a father who he was farewelling. That's where training comes really, it's invaluable, because it's great to have empathy, but you also need the skills and the knowledge to be able to approach every situation.
So Amanda supported both myself and the students in the class. For myself, she talked to me about how Lockie was going at home before he came back to school. But also for the kids in the class, you know, they hadn't experienced that very often before. So Amanda talked to the whole class about treating Lockie the same as we always had, that we didn't want him to feel like he was different or, you know, that he couldn't just come back to school as he had been before.
If I didn't really sort of have that support at school, I don't think I probably would have been at school as much. I don't think I would have been able to sort of get myself together enough to sort of come and be able to learn. So with my dad dying on my birthday, it was something that was always just something I was like very aware of in my childhood, like that day was coming up. When I was in grade 7, my birthday fell on our grade 7 camp.
So it was still in that acute grief stage, and he was having his birthday on camp, which obviously was the anniversary of Dad's passing. So I was in Lockie's camp group and just made that really fun and special. And
yeah, I definitely wouldn't be the person I am today without Chappie Amanda's help and just support.
And I often say she's like the glue that holds us all together as well.
Chaplaincy is a real opportunity to make sure that someone's there for these kids when they go through all kinds of hardships.
So like when I was like trying to pick out a career, my like main focus of something I wanted to do was just something that helped other people. Like in the way that Chaplain Amanda helped me, I don't even think she realises like how much like I based like my own like career choice off of her. Thank you to everyone who supports school chaplaincy, because without them I wouldn't have had Chaplain Amanda to support me and help me become the person I am today.
Father, this morning especially we take time to remember our Chappies. We thank you for the work that they do, for the journeys that they walk with students. Some of these journeys are very, very tough. So Lord, we thank you for the training that goes into Chappies. We thank you for their passion, for their willingness to be involved with these kids. Lord, we thank you for Scripture Union, for being able to supply Chappies the training they need, the support they need. So, Lord, we lift up the work of Scripture Union to you this morning. And, Lord, we remember that coming up in these September holidays is the Maribor Madness Camp. Lord, we lift up these times because we know that these are very special times for kids. They are times when they are valued. They are times when they are appreciated. They are times when they come into contact with people who know and love you. So, Lord, for Maribyrnong Madness this year, we lift it up to you. We pray that it may be a safe time where kids are able to hear of you and your love for them. Pray this in your name. Amen. Let's continue in prayer. Father, we thank you for our families. We pray for those who don't yet know you. We pray for those who are in pain. We pray for those who are in sorrow. We pray for those who are going through tough times. Lord, we lift them up to you. And Lord, for our church family, we lift up those that we especially know who are having a bit of a hard time at the moment, Lord. Lord, for Judy as she goes through further investigation and the team looks at a treatment plan for her, we lift her up to you. We ask for her patience in this time, but the things that may go smoothly for her. Lord, for Robin and her migraine-type headaches, Lord, we lift her up to you. These are debilitating experiences. Lord, we pray that the treating team may have wisdom and knowledge of best how to manage it. Lord, for Marilyn's friend Elizabeth, just been through recent surgery, Lord, with a surprising outcome. But Lord, we lift her up to you as her, in her recovery. May it be full and complete and pain-free. Lord, for Gary and Leanne Day, as they walk this journey at this time, where he's short of energy in these last days of his life on this earth, Lord, we lift them up to you. Lord, for Bev, as she adjusts to life without Andy, Lord, may you be her strength day by day. Lord, for Damien, as he struggles with life at the moment and lability of mood and just flaring up with anger and stuff, Lord, we lift him up to you. Lord, grant him patience and peace and comfort. May he be reminded that you are Lord God and you are his friend and you walk with him every second of every day. And Lord, for Rhys, we lift him up to you in his constant pain and the flare-ups of the pain, Lord. We ask for wisdom and knowledge for the treating team that the surgery may come soon to be a relief of the pain, Lord. Lord, for our community, for those without safe haven, for those who don't know where their next meal is, for those who are isolated, for those who are incarcerated, Lord, we lift them up to you. We don't have all the answers about how to meet all their needs, but Lord, you are aware of them and you love them and you care for them. Lord, help us to be a vision of you to them. Lord, for Afghanistan and the persecuted church. Lord, for the church, we pray that you strengthen them in their faith so that they can remain strong in you under the intense pressure that they're under. For those who are sick in these countries, Lord, in whether it's COVID or otherwise, as the health systems are under pressure, Lord, we lift them up to you. Lord, for women and girls who are disrespected under the new regimes, Lord, we lift them up to you. And Lord, for the Taliban and other extremist groups, we pray that they may come to a saving knowledge of you, the one true living God and a God of love, not hate and deceit. And Lord, for ourselves, strengthen us in our faith so that we may be your glory in whatever our circumstances are. Lord, we pray that you continue your good work in us, the work that you have started, so that we may be mature in our knowledge of you and our work that you have prepared us for. Lord, we pray these things in and through your name. Amen.
Let's continue to turn our hearts toward our Father as we prepare. prepare to hear what he has to say to us through what Rhys brings, or even not anything to do with that. But, you know, Jesus said that we needed to have ears that would listen. And so, Father, we turn our hearts towards you. We continue to turn our hearts towards you and know that you receive us. You long for us. You delight in us. And our heart's response is, God, here's our heart. Here's our heart.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found. Speak what is true.
Appreciate the work that our worship teams are putting in to lead us into this awareness of God's presence, this ability that they have and are crafting together in all of our teams. And the energy that they're putting into the equipping sessions with Mark and Katie Beresford and that whole idea of this business of worship. It's not just about singing a song, it's actually about our response to the manifest presence of God. And just really appreciate all of our worshippers and worship teams and us as well as we're participating in that journey with them. Well, this morning as we come into Codebreaker 17, we need to understand in this story where Jesus' family concerned that he's not quite right, and the investigators from Jerusalem are coming to check him out and deciding that he's performing all of these things by the prince of demons, Beelzebul. It's quite fascinating that the run-up to this has been incredibly unprecedented, both in their world and ours, and remarkable. That here this Jewish carpenter emerges innocuously from a place in the north in Nazareth, a place considered to be not a place. And he emerges and he's standing the priests on their ear and he's standing the scribes on their ear and he's calling out the sectarian Pharisees. He's in amazing ways setting people free with healing and deliverance and really advocating in a very real sense the presence of the kingdom of God. And now in this story, he's nose to nose, face to face with the opposition. And it's actually another one of these difficult stories, but we can't step around them. So we have to step into them to try to understand what's going on. Now, in my 5 years, in my primary theological training, my 5 years of that foundational training, in all of that time, we dedicated one half of one lecture, about 20 minutes in total, to demonology. That's all. In the context of the hundreds and hundreds of hours of lecture where we looked at theology, theos, God, the study of God. We looked at Christology, the study of Christ. We looked at soteriology, the study of the cross. We looked at pneumatology, the study of the spirit. We looked at missiology, the study of the church in mission. We looked at ecclesiology, how the church functions. But 20 minutes on demonology. And I was talking to my brother Jeff Armitage this morning around some of this. One of our lecturers, Max Davidson, an incredible man, he was doing a Master's of Theology. And in that, he learned German just to be able to read the original texts of the German theologians as he looked into angelology in the book of Enoch. There you go, knock yourselves out with that one, right? And you know, Max's first draft of his master's thesis was immediately upgraded to PhD. Brilliant man. But you know, we never got any of the cream. But I'm a bit glad about that, actually, in some respects. Not that we didn't gain some insights from Max around that stuff. But there were some of my students that felt that this was really insufficient. But I'm actually really pleased with the grounding that we received in what is true and what is right, rather than trying to cover off all the counterfeits, all of that. You would have heard me speak a couple of weeks ago on some of my interactions in spiritual warfare. I never bothered talking to these things because they just lie anyway. Satan is called the father of lies for a very, very, very good reason. They just won't tell you the truth. So it's a waste of time. But here in this particular story, we've got Jesus' family now coming forward, expressing concerns that he's deluded. And the Jerusalem heavyweights, well, they go way beyond that. So let's have a look at the passage this morning from Mark chapter 3, verses 20 to 35. Mark records, "Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, 'He's out of his mind.' And the teachers of the law came down from Jerusalem, said, 'He's possessed by Beelzebul. By the prince of demons, he's driving out demons.' So Jesus called them over to him and began to speak to them in parables. 'How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. If Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly, I say to you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of an eternal sin.' He said this because they were saying, 'He has an impure spirit.' Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived standing outside." Note that, standing outside. "They sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him and they told him, 'Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you.' 'Who are my mother and my brothers?' he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, 'Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother.'" This is an incredibly emotionally charged scene here. When Jesus returns home, he's inundated again. The crowds engulf him. And now his own family, they are convinced he is out of his mind. And they urge him to cease and desist. And to make matters worse, you've got the scribes coming down from Jerusalem. These are the heavyweights. These aren't just the local jurisdiction. These are the big boys. And they're coming down and their intent is to mount a counter-offensive. So in this story, Mark acknowledges the two pillars of authority of their society. The first pillar, the clan, the family, kinship. The second pillar, the state. And both work together to see control of people under the call to not rock the boat, to maintain the status quo. To his family, he's deluded, a lunatic. To his political opponents, he is demonic. Oh, it's even hard to say that. What was going on in their heads? So I want to deal with the opposition from opponents first. So Jesus is confronted by these Jerusalem scribes who assert that he's demonic, and that's what they lead with. What we need to understand that in traditional cultures, it's common for those in power to question an exorcist who assumes a positive, active, and above all, like an actively militant kind of political role. And we see that with Jesus' refusal to bow down to the Pharisaical regulations and control of the Sabbath. We see that through his eroding of the priestly caste and their hold on the holiness code to define who is in and out. The scribes with their capacity and overseeing the debt code, and Jesus is eroding it all. But this strategy to name and defame, it's a strategy that's designed to distance. It seeks to actually objectify, to discredit. Sound familiar? To sever and deny any links. You're not one of us, you're of them. When those in power or those who ascribe to be are challenged or feel threatened, they try to neutralize the challenges by identifying them as something else, particularly with mythical cultural demons. And the logic of the scribes in this story is actually quite straightforward. They believed themselves to be God's representatives. So Jesus, breaking from their power structures and his constant opposition of their traditions, from their perspective, if they're God's representatives, who might Jesus be in allegiance with? That's their reasoning. And so they construct a story to discredit him. And the scribes use a double wording for Satan in this story. The first is Beelzebul, and it's probably derived from the Hebrew with the connotation of height or abiding or dwelling. And the name means the Lord of the dwelling, with reference to the heir and or to the possessed in whom he dwells. And the second is the prince of demons, echoing the language of principalities and powers that's found through the New Testament. So the dialogue of the scribes is definitely and specifically political at this point. So the battleground has moved from the synagogue exorcism of Mark chapter 1, verses 21, when Jesus came back from the encounter in the wilderness to the synagogue, and the man with the spirit who was coexisting within their system, he exposes, "I know who you are," and Jesus dealt with this presence. And then there was the Son of Man incident of Mark chapter 2 with the scribal authority, that challenge to their symbolic order, the debt code, and to show you that the Son of Man has authority to forgive sin, which is easier. Pick up your mat and walk, and he did. Confounded them. But now he goes directly nose to nose, opposing their attempt to control the story. And here is the point. When we refuse the pursuit of self-interest and we oppose the powerful and the bullies and the abuses of power on the vulnerable, when we do that,
It exposes their power agenda. And those who pursue self-interest. It exposes them. And the only place they've got left is to come after you. And at that point, it's game on. And let me tell you, I've had my share of criticism over the years. I know how this works. When people finally work out that they can't control you, they seek to control the story around you. It's true. Because they want to control how others see you. Look, I could, unfortunately and sadly, I could tell you story after story after story. It's lamentable that even from people who identify as Christian and even Christian leaders, but that's exactly what is going on here with Jesus and these accusations against him. But then you see Jesus, and it, for me, it always happens after the fact. I kind of, you know, after you've had an interaction, you think, oh, I wish I had said this. I wish I had said that. Not with Jesus. He just goes straight on the front foot. He counters with a story of his own. So he places the ball back into the court of the Pharisees. He calls them over and began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? A king divided itself can't stand. A house divided can't stand. Satan opposes himself, divided can't stand. His time has come. No one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he plunders the strong man's house. By this, he's placing the ball back in their court. Return serve. I always come up with those sorts of things after the fact. But he short circuits their self-serving observations and he unmasks all their contradictions. And Jesus causes it all to implode on itself. And then he likens his mission. It's really important that we get a hold of the language that Jesus is using there. He likens his mission to a burglar breaking and entering. No one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he can plunder. Then. And Jesus is introducing two really important prophetic references here. The first one is this Greek word skuen, which is the idea of goods. You plunder goods. And the only other time that Mark uses this word is in chapter 11 and verse 16. And that, my friends, is when Jesus storms the temple. He overchanges the money changers' tables, which are exploiting the vulnerable, and he drives them out with a whip and said, "You are forbidden to carry goods, skuen." So that story is meant to be read through this lens. The strong man has been bound. Whew. Whoa. Now, doesn't that lift both stories? Amazing. In other words, this parable is meant to inform that story in Mark 11. Fascinating. I don't just love the stories of this book. I love the way of the stories of this book. The way of them. Amazing. And now Mark is coming clean. Jesus is the stronger one. Heralded by John in Mark chapter 1, one will follow me. I cannot even tie his sandals. I'm not worthy of it. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. In other words, he will reclothe you in your right mind. Isn't it fascinating that here there are people saying he is not in his right mind? Fascinating. The very one who is the true human one, the very one who is a human being as intended, always clothed in God and clothed in his right mind. Fascinating. But what we find is Jesus delivering on a promise of Isaiah 49 and 24. Let's have a look at that. It says this: can plunder be taken from warriors or captives be rescued from the fierce? But this is what the Lord says. Yes, captives will be taken from warriors and plunder retrieved from the fierce. I will contend. This is the Lord. You know, one thing I've learned about the Lord, he wins. The Lord says, I will contend with those who contend with you. It's not our fight. The battle is not ours. It's his. I will contend with those who contend with you, and your children I will save. And Jesus draws into the imagery of a burglar breaking and entering. And this became one of the earliest Christian traditions, with the Lord returning as a thief in the night. And Matthew 24 and 43 and 1 Thessalonians 5 and 2, 2 Peter 3 and 10, Revelation 3 and 3 and 16 and 15. There's a stack of references in the New Testament about the Lord returning as a thief in the night. And it all flows out of this story. But Jesus doesn't quite stop there. Further on in another gospel, in Matthew's gospel, in chapter 15, verses 8 to 14, he continues with his directness in addressing these scribal elite, calling all the elite blind guides. Look at this. He replied, you hypocrites, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. You know, we've just sung, here's my heart, Lord, speak what is true. Here's my life, Lord. Verse 9, they worship me in vain and their teachings, look at this, their teachings are merely human rules. Jesus called the crowd to him and said, listen and understand, what goes into someone's mouth does not defile them, but what comes out of their mouth is what defiles them. And then the disciples came to him and asked, you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this? Oh, really? He replied, every plant, look at this, every plant that my heavenly Father, oh, I'm sorry, it should be up. There it is there. Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them. They are blind guides. If the blind leads the blind, they both fall into a ditch. So true. Remember, back in the Woodridge days, Celia, we had a fellow that was legally blind, and he had a brother that would come to pick him up and help him walk, help John walk home. And the brother, often on a Saturday night, would tie one on and stand in the foyer of the church, three parts cut still from the night before, blind, leading blind John home. And just up the road from the church, there was a culvert. Guess what happened? Yep, they both fell in the ditch. But this is what the scribal class can't see. By the close of this interaction, Jesus has turned the tables completely on them. It's they who are aligned against God's purposes, not him. It's both they and those vulnerable to their power abuses who are captive to the way things are. Rejoice when people say things against you that are not true. I say again, rejoice, for rich and great is your reward in heaven. To resist criticism and change and to brutally suppress efforts to humanize their systems and practice inclusivity, to resist that is to be bypassed by the grace of God. Those who lend to the poor give to God. So that deals with the opponents. And then you've got the family. So in the ancient Mediterranean world, the kingship system is rigidly determinative of personality and identity. It also controlled the vocational work prospects and facilitated the overall interaction in the society. And Jesus' family at this point sought to rein him in, no doubt for his own protection in their minds, but also for the sake of their reputation. I remember when I was invited to start SWIM as an urban mission work. And at the Baptist executive table, I was asked the question, what is this going to cost us? I said, if you're going to ask that question, you can't afford it. And the fellow said, well, there you have it, straight from the horse's mouth, we can't afford it. And one of the other brothers at the table who knew me very well, he actually said, you know that's not what he's saying. This will cost us our reputation. This will cost us more than money. It will cost us our time, our talent, our treasure. It will cost us more than we have money to pay for. He understood what I was saying. I think the other fella did too. But in chapter 3 and verse 31, after this clash with the scribal investigators, the family members redouble. They double down on their efforts to restrain him. And Mark underscores that tension. Contrary to what we might think, the disciples and the others, the outsiders, are inside the house, where Jesus' family is outside. That's profound. That's profound. Jesus understands that in order to weave an alternative story, to create an alternative social fabric, the most basic conventions and constraints of kinship must be questioned. And Jesus concludes redefining his family as those who do the will of God. Those who do the will of God. Some of us might have families and part of families that may not have be in faith and think that we're quite loony. I just say you'd be quite right. I mean, who in their right mind would put their trust in a life that they never lived and a death that they never died for their eternity? We're quite strange, I think. But you know, here is, I think, for us a significant marker. There are plenty who go by the term Christian. And isn't it sad that in the minds of many, it's a term that's too often associated with abuse of people, the misappropriation of money, unsavory and unquestionable practices. But we know these things are not the will of God. Jesus defines his family as those who do the will of God, those who practice justice, those who love mercy, those who walk humbly with God, those who are hospitable, those who are generous with love and inclusivity as their banner, those who practice mercy and compassion towards the vulnerable and the poor, those who are just, those who are faithful to God and others, those who live out a simple kindness because they belong to Jesus. It's these ones who are his family. So, as we bring this together now, as we reflect for a moment or three, the questions roll. Who do you say Jesus is? Is he a liar or a lunatic or the Lord? Who is he to you? Not who the other people say he is, but who is he to you? The next question. I wonder if you've suffered the indignity of people saying things about you that are not true. That maybe you need some help to get over the hump of that, to recover from, to be able to walk forward. Because somewhere, somehow, despite the circumstances that I experienced in Canberra, my prayer partner Jeff Armitage said that even while I was journeying through that, Lord, you had your eye on Maryborough. What a great gift you are to Jackie and I. What a great gift you are to us. To bring healing to us. Hope and encouragement and restoration to us. It's wonderful. The next question. I mean, we all need a hand when we've been violated like this to get over the hump. Next question. Where do you derive your sense of identity from? Is it from your family? Maybe your role as a father or a mother or, you know, whatever your role might be, others? Or is it being part of the family of Jesus? Where do you derive your identity from? I spoke at a men's breakfast yesterday morning. Galatians 2:20 was very strong. I have been crucified with Christ, full stop. Full stop. I'm just going to sit there. My identity is no longer my own. I have been crucified with Christ, but I no longer live, but Christ live in me. And the life I now live in the body, I live through faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So it's no longer about me. It's actually about him. I am bought with a price. I am no longer my own. But where do you derive your identity from? For me, it's a full stop. I have been crucified with Christ. Full stop. So finally, who is your family? Who is your family? I'm proud to say Maryborough Baptist Church is my family. I'm proud. But who is your family? I trust that all of this becomes really, really clear because he is the human one that came to recover and restore what is right by removing what was wrong. Let's pray together. Because, Father, this is a profound story. The accusations against Jesus, his way of exposing the agendas, the power agendas of those within it, and his way of circumventing the conversation. The picture of his flesh and blood family outside, and I don't believe that he intended any disrespect to them, but recognizing those inside are indeed his family, those who are doing the will of God. Oh, that we would be that people who do the will of God and take our place as your family. And again, I'm just reminded, Lord, that wonderful passage in Revelation 19, where the garments that are worn by your family members are a rich and white linen that are woven together of threads of the good deeds. And it's not a works-based salvation, but rather kindness because we belong to you that we extend to others. And that on that day, we stand clothed in these garments before you. And that these are the good deeds that you have prepared in advance for us to do. And so, Father, in your goodness and your grace, we commend ourselves, our online family as well, and each other, in the name of Jesus. Amen. You know, we're going to move straight to the communion table today. Ross and June, can I ask you please to come and unveil the table for us? I'd like to draw our attention back to the Isaiah 49 passage. Can plunder be taken from warriors or captives rescued from the fierce? But this is what the Lord says. Yes, captives will be taken from warriors and plunders retrieved from the fierce. I will contend with those who contend with you. We have a God who contends on our behalf. And the terms that he contends on our behalf, he provides himself. Fascinating. And as I think about that, and I come over to another favorite passage in Isaiah 55, and this is what it says, chapter 1 and following. Come all who are thirsty. Are you thirsty this morning? I know I am. Come to the waters, and you who have no money. Any millionaires in the congregation? Good for a loan? You who have no money. Not that God doesn't love millionaires, he does. A lot of millionaires I know are very, very generous. But come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me and eat what is good. Your soul will delight in the richest of fare. Give ear and come to me. Hear me that your soul may live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you. Listen to this. My unfailing kindness. My unfailing kindnesses as promised to David. You know, we look at the table and the terms that God purchased us to place us on display. And there will be people that say horrible things about us, because if they said horrible things about Jesus, how can they say not horrible things about us if we're following him? But take courage when they do, that rich is your reward in heaven. The delight of God is on you. the story around the terms of God contending for us is his body that was broken, not by the priests controlling the holiness code, the scribes controlling the debt code, or the sectarian Pharisees regulating the law of who is in and acceptable and who is out. Jesus says to all, come, come, all who are thirsty and hungry. There's no conditions on that all. It's an invitation to all to come. Come to this table. Let's pray together with gratitude. Because Father, we say thank you so much that you contended for us, that you stood up, advocated for us. You restored what was right by removing what was wrong. You disempowered, disarmed the holiness codes, the debt codes, the regulations of the law, and you established yourself and your presence among us of your Spirit, that we come thirsting for this, the richness of this relationship, the kindnesses that you had promised to David. We realize completely in the person of Jesus. And this morning we say thank you. It seems so inadequate, but we say thank you for your grace, that a life that we didn't live and a death that we didn't die, that we can put our trust in for our eternity. In the name of Jesus, amen. And you know something about the mystery of the table? Even if you still may have questions about some of these things, the table is here for you too. Don't think that this is just for the insiders. The table is for all. And so if you happen to be our guest this morning, you are welcome to participate in this table. If you're visiting, you are welcome. If you have faith, you are welcome. If you don't have faith yet, you are still welcome. You are welcome. This table is for you. And so as the Ross and June distribute the elements, please take the bread at your own convenience, but hang on to the cup so that we can drink together as a symbolism of our unity. Thank you. And you know, the story in 1 Corinthians 11 opens up on the night that Jesus was betrayed. Here in the face of great faithlessness, there is an expression of incredible faithfulness, where Jesus took the bread, broke it. This represents my body, broken for you. And so we eat the body together, that which represents him. And then the third cup, the cup of salvation, this cup represents my blood shed for you. This is the terms of the new covenant. This is how I contend for you and those you love, you and your children. Let's drink together. Simple things, and yet faith, Father, is so simple that we so treasure being part of your family, part of the family here at Maryborough Baptist Church. And we so treasure that you will continue to increase this family because, Lord, you would say to us that there's always room for one more at your table. So, Father, we thank you for your grace, for your mercy, and for your love. And as we bring our time together with a song. What more appropriate song could we sing than King of Kings, that you are indeed the King of Kings. Amen. Friends, you might like to pass your cups to the end. Nadine will come.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without life, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. You rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Have a cup of tea with us afterwards, and if you want to have a chat or some prayer, I'd be more than delighted to pray with you. Gwen is here, Tony is here, Tim is here, or someone that you've come with. Let's, if there are things that we need to talk to God about and pray about, then let's do that today. But and to our online family, thanks so much for tuning in today. You bless our socks off every time we see you tuning in and giving us feedback around our gatherings. It's sad that you can't be with us to have a cup of tea, but maybe one day, or at least on that day, we'll see you there. But please join us for a cup of tea, but I'm going to ask the team to give us one more praise the Father, hey? What do you reckon? One more to sing us out.
Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Son.